When I was first asked to speak today at this missions convention, I actually had already started thinking about what God would have me to do and speak in the verse, and I had already started to think and prepare and pray about what to speak on. And it was a great comfort to me whenever Pastor James got in contact with me and told me what the theme was of this missions convention. The missions convention is sent, and coming from the book of John chapter 20, and that was already what God had laid upon my heart and I was preparing to speak on. And I thank God for his spirit and his guidance. Thank him for his name that truly breaks all those chains. I want to speak the name of Jesus. I actually think the music might have got in your way, Chip. That was well done. If you'd open your Bibles this morning to John chapter 20, I'd like to begin reading this morning, not just verse 21, but I want to read also a little earlier, start with verse 19. John chapter 20, beginning with verse 19 through 22. Now I'll read from the New International Version this morning. If you have your Bible on your as book form, paper, or on your cell phone, feel free to read along with me. I'm reading from the New International Version today. And it reads, "On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, 'Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you.' And with that, he breathed on them and said, 'Receive the Holy Spirit.'" Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. God, I pray that today as we look into your word, Lord, that you would guide us, that you would direct us. Father, that we would know that your Holy Spirit is working in our hearts today. God, I pray, Lord, that we would all be drawn closer to you. And Lord, I pray that as we leave here today, God, that all of us, Lord, will leave here changed and different than we were when we came in. Work in our hearts, oh God. Draw us closer to you. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. This event takes place actually on Resurrection Day. This is recorded for us in the book of John after Jesus has had an amazing 3 years of public ministry. At the end of his ministry, all of you already know, or most of you know, that he was arrested, he was tried, he was convicted, and he was executed on the cross. But we can be thankful that that was not the end of his story. That was not the end of the story. It didn't end with Jesus dying on the cross, but it really was a mark of a beginning. A mark of a beginning that him as a resurrected Christ, him as the one that defeated death and the grave, being raised on that third day. Earlier in chapter 20, it's recorded for us that Mary Magdalene, she goes to the tomb early in the morning while it's still dark. And she gets to that tomb expecting the stone to be there, expecting it to be still sealed up, expecting Jesus to be laying there in that tomb. Instead, the stone is rolled away and the tomb is completely empty. To much their surprise and fear and not knowing what's happened to Jesus' body, she runs and she tells the disciples. The disciples, and wanting to figure out what happened to Jesus' body as well, they rush to the tomb. The scripture tells us in John that Peter and John get there and they go into the tomb, they run inside. As they go inside, all they see there is the grave clothes. The linen that had been wrapped around Jesus, the linen that had been on him, that's all that's there. His body is gone. And seeing this at the tomb, did the disciples celebrate that Jesus had been risen from the grave? No. Instead, they wondered who had taken his body. And they slipped away in fear. Mary Magdalene, she stayed at the grave. Heart stricken. Not knowing what had happened to Jesus, she stays at the grave as John records it for us, and she's weeping. And as she was weeping, the scripture tells us that two angels appeared in the tomb, sitting at either end of where Jesus' body had been laid. And as they ask her, you know, why are you crying? Why are you looking for Jesus here? He's alive. And at that point, Jesus appears to her. As he appears to her, she knows that he's alive. She goes and tells the disciples, and she tells the disciples what had happened, but yet they still don't seem to be celebrating their risen Savior. As we pick up the story of where they're at on this day, this resurrection day, we find the disciples on that evening that they're locked away. They're locked away in the room for fear of the authorities, for fear of what might happen to them. The powers and the people that were in charge had already arrested their Jesus. He had already died on the cross, and they were afraid the same could happen to them. So they shrunk away in fear and were locked away in a house. You got to think about these disciples and what an amazing 3 years they've had. These men that had left everything to follow Jesus. They left their positions. They left their jobs. They left their families. They left their incomes behind. They followed him. They had witnessed firsthand the miracle-working power of Christ when he healed the lame. They were there. When he prayed and opened the blinded eyes, they were there. When he spit on the ground and made saliva and put it in the man's eyes, they were there. They witnessed it. When he healed the deaf, they were there. When he cast out demons from that demoniac, they were there. When he walked on water, they were in the boat. They saw his power. When he fed the thousands, there were 5,000 men, probably around 20,000 people with just those 5 loaves and those 2 fish. They were there. They saw it all. They saw it all firsthand. And no doubt we can tell from their discussions that in arguments that they fully expected the good times to keep rolling. They fully expected that everything would keep going their way. They had big dreams. They had expectations. They had arguments amongst themselves on who was going to be the greatest in the kingdom of God? Who was going to be closer to Jesus in his kingdom? They had a complete misunderstanding of the kingdom that Jesus was going to establish. We can tell from their arguments, from their understanding, even though they were there listening to Jesus, even though he told them, oh, time and again, I'm not here to establish a political kingdom. My kingdom is not of this world. My kingdom is a heavenly kingdom. I've been sent by the Father. He was here for a different purpose, but for them and their minds, I'm sure they were looking at places of prestige following Jesus. But in a matter of just 3 days, or really 4 days when you think about when Jesus was arrested and died, or 6 days, the days that they had waited after Jesus' arrest, their whole world had fallen apart. The one that they had called King of Kings and Lord of Lords had been arrested. The Almighty Jesus had been tried. The Son of God was put to death on a cross. And now they find themselves hiding in fear. All of those dreams that they had, all that they thought was going to take place, all that they thought there was going to happen as the kingdom was set up again in Jerusalem, in their mind, they thought they were going to throw the Romans out. They're going to take over. They may have even already started building their house in their minds where they were going to live in Jerusalem. Certainly they would have a great place and great position in this new kingdom. They had done all of that. I worked with a French missionary for many years in Laos, and he used to call it, when you had these big expectations of things that probably weren't going to happen, he called it building castles in Spain. Evidently, that's a term in French that they make, that you're building castles in Spain. And I imagine these disciples were building castles in Spain. Expectations that the Lord didn't expect for them, were planned that he did not have for them, but they had and made for themselves. They're big dreams. And even though for them they thought that it had all been lost, in reality, this was all just the beginning for them. You see, they had plans. And we all have plans for our lives and things that we'd like to see happen. There's nothing wrong with that. I think we have dreams and hopes and desires for what we do and the things that we'll attain in this world. Nothing wrong with that at all. But you may be here today and you may be in a similar situation to those disciples. I think probably many of us in our lives have gone through things like that where we've had big plans and big dreams and things that we hope to see happen and they just didn't happen. They didn't happen like we wanted it to. We didn't get the promotion that we might have wanted at work. We weren't able to get the things that we wanted or the things that we desired just didn't happen. Perhaps things in relationships didn't happen like you wanted them to. They just didn't come together. And we find ourselves disappointed. We find ourselves in a place of disappointment, but we have to also ask ourselves, is our disappointment that perhaps this plan that we had made, perhaps it was our plan, but perhaps it wasn't God's plan for your life. Perhaps it wasn't what He wanted to take place in your life. Perhaps it's not what He had hoped for you. It is possible at times that our plans are not God's plans. The disciples who are with Jesus day in and day out, hearing Him teach, being with Him personally, being with Him day in and day out, they were certainly making plans that were not God's plans. They were hoping for things that God had not intended. In Matthew chapter 20, verse 20, we have the ultimate tiger mom in our Asian context of James and John's mother coming to Jesus. Many of you will remember the story. She comes to Jesus and she has a request. She says, "Grant that one of these two sons of mine may sit at your right and the other at your left in your kingdom." And Jesus tells her, He says, "You don't know what you're asking." Jesus said to them, "Can you drink of the cup I am going to drink?" And the sons answered, they said, "We can. We can drink. We can." Of course, Jesus knew what was going to happen. And He knew that indeed they would one day, but when the first test came, when He was arrested and He went to trial, when He went to that cross, all of these men that were closest to Him that had pledged themselves, that said, He said, "Can you do what I'm going to have to do?" And they all said, "Yes, we can." All of them deserted Him. All of them, with the exception of possibly John, left Him when He went to the cross. They weren't there when He was standing before His closest, one of His main leaders, Peter, you'll remember the story well, hiding outside the temple in fear and even denying that he even knew Jesus, much less one of His disciples. These men fell in fear and now find themselves hiding behind a locked door. Our plans don't always come to pass because they're not always in line with what Jesus plans for our life. See, Jesus' plans for us and the Church of Jesus Christ has not changed in more than 2,000 years. It hasn't changed in all the years. It hasn't changed since He first said the words to the disciples. He still wants to bless us. He wants to guide us just like He did the first disciples. But Jesus' plan, His first plan is that He wants us to know Him. Wants us to know Him. The disciples, Jesus could have left them in that locked room. He certainly could have chosen other people to be His leaders. He could have said, "Well, you guys, you failed the test. You disappointed me. You made choices and decisions in your life that betrayed me as your Savior. Peter, you've sinned. You've done wrong. You've even cursed and saying you didn't know me. Completely deserted." But Jesus, in His love for them, is the same as He does for us. See, it didn't matter where they went, what they did, He doesn't stop His love. It doesn't matter where you've gone. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter the decisions that you've made in your life. You cannot outrun the love of God. And just as Jesus went to show Himself to those disciples, to show Himself to the men who had betrayed Him, who had pledged to be with him, who had said, we'll be with you, Lord. We'll be with you right to the end. They fell away. But yet Jesus meets them where they are. He goes to them. He goes to them, and he goes to them just as he comes to us. Because it doesn't matter where you've been, what you've done. You may be here today, and you may be thinking to yourself, because of some decisions that I've made in life, decisions that I've made and the things I've participated in, I have somehow disqualified myself from being a follower of Christ. Let me tell you today, there is no such position. There is no such place, no such thing that you could have done or would have done that would be too far for his forgiveness. That would be too far for him to reach down and touch, for him to meet you where you are. Just as he went and met those disciples that day, as we are, he met them in a personal way. He does the same thing today. He does the same thing with the world that we live in. He meets us where we are. The scripture tells us, we read, that he shows up. The door's bolted, it's locked up, but yet through a miraculous power, it doesn't say he knocked at the door and they opened it. He appeared before them. You say, how did Jesus do that? He's Jesus. He can do whatever he wants to do. He appeared before them. In appearing before them, he made sure that they saw the scars on his hands, on his body. He made sure that they saw in his side where the spear had pierced his side. He wanted them to see that so that they would know that he's not some ghost. He's not some ghost of a spirit somehow. But he's Jesus resurrected. The same body that had walked the earth for 33 years. The same body that had hung on that cross. The same body that had died on that cross, been placed in that tomb. That was the same Jesus that was standing before them. Show them who he was in a personal and real way. Jesus wants that kind of a personal and real relationship, the same as he had with the disciples. He wants that real and personal relationship with us. It doesn't matter where we've been. It doesn't matter what we've done. It doesn't matter if you say, but I failed him in the past. Look what the disciples did. Completely betrayed him. Yet he came and he met them where they were. He wants, and just as he sent them, he wants to send us to do his work. Jesus tells his disciples, peace be with you. A common greeting, shalom, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. He has a plan for his disciples, and truly, these disciples at this point in time, and after seeing the resurrection of Jesus, seeing his body crucified, seeing him, that he died on the cross, seeing a risen Savior, something clicked for them. As they received the Holy Spirit, as they received an understanding of who he was, and truly these men did drink from that cup. They sacrificed. They gave of themselves. They were sent. They took the gospel of Jesus Christ around the world, and they did what he had asked them to do. His plan for us, his plan for them, was to carry on the work. Just as he carried on his Father's work, he's sending us. That is what this whole missions convention is about. That's why every year United Bethel Church focuses on missions, why we talk about and we preach on and we focus and we do faith promises. It's all about fulfilling this word that Christ has given us, and it's why I'm wearing this Indonesian shirt today. To help to remind us that there's a world outside of our church, there's a world outside of our communities, there are people out there that need us to come, that need us to be sent. That need us to go, that need us to go and to share the gospel with them. That's what it's all about. As followers of his, we're to be sent to do his work. In Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 through 20, as Matthew records it for us, when Jesus had appeared before the disciples the last time, Jesus tells them, he says, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. We're to go and make disciples of all nations. I love our theme. Sent. Sent where? Sent everywhere. Sent to who? Sent to everybody. Because everywhere needs to know Jesus. And everybody needs to know who he is. Sending us. As his followers, we're to be sent to all nations. All nations. Not just here in the Philippines, but around the world, to all nations. Shelly and I, in addition to living, working here in Manila, we also serve as area directors for Assembly of God World Mission in Southeast Asia. And as that, we have the privilege to work in six other countries. We work in part of the six countries, the Philippines, Malaysia, Singapore, Indonesia, Brunei, and Timor-Leste. It's like I forgot one. I got them all. And in these nations, there's about 420 million people that live there. 420 million. 420 million. 280 million just in Indonesia alone. And in these millions of people that live in these nations, there are places and that in these places, there's millions and millions of people that have yet to hear the name of Jesus. They live in a place outside the gospel of Jesus Christ. Even though for 2,000 years, it's been around 2,000 years since Jesus stood in front of his disciples. He said, as the Father has sent me, I am now sending you. And he blew on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. It's been around 2,000 years since people have been sent. But even though in that 2,000 years, we still have parts of this world, we still have parts of those six nations where the gospel has never been preached. So how can that be in 2,000 years of church history? Quite frankly, it can be because no one's ever gone. No one's ever gone. No one's ever gone and lived amongst the people. No one's ever gone and shared the gospel amongst the people. No one's ever gone. Say, well, how can that be? It's because they're hard places. The easy spots have been taken a long time ago. What's left are difficult and challenging places. But even though it's difficult and it's challenging, it certainly does mean that the gospel of Jesus Christ can't go forward. I know that Sam spoke here last week. Bhante Lau, you're getting two Sams in a row. But Sam, I know, spoke here last week, and I'm sure he talked about what's happening down in, he talked about what's happening in Mindanao, didn't he? Yeah, think about that. Down in Mindanao, in places that 10 years ago when we would come together and pray for Mindanao and pray about the islands just here in the Philippines, as much witness as we have for Christ, there's islands down there where no Christians ever lived. No one's ever gone. No churches there, no witnesses there. But how exciting it is today through that initiative and through our church and the Philippine Assemblies of God and sending out missionaries and now over 40 people, so I think 42 is the last number I saw, 42 workers living and working in places that 10 years ago I would have been told and you would have been told that's impossible. It's impossible for Christians to go there. It's hard. They don't like us. And some don't. They don't like us. They don't want us to be there. Some don't. But Jesus does. And Jesus has sent. And when Jesus sent, he's called us to go to all nations. He didn't put any exception in there. There's no exception. There's no all nations except Islamic countries. It's not all nations except Buddhist countries. It's not all nations except the animist people. It's all nations. Everyone. We're called. We're sent. We're empowered with the Holy Spirit because we don't go alone. We don't go by ourselves. It's difficult. But Jesus, when he told them, he didn't just tell them that they're sent. He blew on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. His Spirit, his power going with them. His Spirit, his power going with us. Taking the gospel of Jesus Christ. Is it easy when we go? No. There'll be challenges along the way. But when we're walking in God's plan, walking in His will for our life, going where He's called us to go, doing what He's called us to do, working in the power of His Holy Spirit, in light of eternity, everything else is going to be okay. As we're sent to go, Jesus goes with us. In our service today, we want to ask ourselves, what's Jesus' plan for your life? What's His plan for your life? What is your role in fulfilling? We already know what His plan is. So much of His plan is written for us so plainly in the Bible. I've had more than once in my time and in life, I've had people come and want to me to pray with them about what God's plan is for their life. And I always lead them back to Scripture. There's so much in Scripture already telling us what we're supposed to do. We already know what we're supposed to do. We already know we're sent. We already know as His followers, we have the Holy Spirit with us and we're called to go. Touch lives for people. Touch lives for the Lord. Just as Shelley mentioned, she goes to the ladies that don't know the Lord. She goes with them every week and does exercises, finds an avenue here in our city to touch the lives of people for Christ. We all have a work to do. We all have a part to play in that plan. Some of you are going to be sent. Some of you are going to be the ones to go. Some of you are going to be the ones that the Lord lays upon His heart. I want you to go to Southern Philippines. I want you to go to Indonesia. I want you to go to Malaysia for my cause. I want you to go to China for my cause. God's going to lay that on your heart. In this church, in this convention, and what we do, we're going to do what churches are supposed to do. We're going to send. We're going to follow a New Testament model of the Antioch church, and we're going to send. Stand with you. The calling that God has on your life. Today, during this convention and through this month, and I'd like to just ask you, what's God's plan for your life? What part are you going to play? That's probably a better question. What part are you going to play in this plan? God's got a plan. He's got a plan. He's laid it down. What part are you going to play?